Okay, in a previous slide, I discussed with you the first stages of the evaluation of measurement uncertainty, definition of measurement, specification of measurement procedure, identification of uncertainty components, quantification of the uncertainty components, and now we'll discuss the last stages. We'll start from the combination of the uncertainty components. Okay, for the combination of the uncertainty components, typically there are different approaches to combine uncertainty components. So after knowing which components are relevant and after getting a standard uncertainty or after quantifying the uncertainty components, you have to combine them. And you must know how the different variables affect the final result. Okay? And there are different strategies. You can use the so-called uncertainty progression law, or you can use numerical methods that are not supported on heavy mathematics, like in this case. If the measurement model is complex, you must do some partial derivatives calculation there, and you can make your life easier if you use the Crichton method or the Monte Carlo method. If you take the Monte Carlo method, you can use a dedicated software, or you can use even Excel, but you will need more computing resources than in other cases. So you need to have computers that are able to run many simulated values. Okay. The MC Tech guide discusses all these three approaches for the evaluation of measurement uncertainty. The GAM only discusses the uncertainty propagation laws, and there is a supplement of the GAM that discusses the Monte Carlo simulations. Okay. In this presentation of the principles of the evaluation of measurement uncertainty, I will discuss the uncertainty propagation law, because although it is more difficult from a mathematical point of view, it allows us to understand how the uncertainty components propagate. And the uncertainty propagation law that I will present to you is the simplest version of the uncertainty propagation law that is applicable to independent variables. Applicable when you have variables like A and B that are completely independent. Okay? In this case, in this example, that is represented in this figure, you have two variables A and B that are not dependent. They are dependent because they are correlated. Imagine that we have a variable I, yes, that is an influence quantity like the temperature, okay, and you have here a normalized value axis. This means that value varies between 0 and 100% of the range of this value. And this is a normalized value so that you can have the same information in the same graph of different things. You have the y here, xA and xB, that are the values for A and B. You understand? So we have two variables that are relevant to calculate our measurement uncertainty or our measurement result. And you have an influence quantity that typically is not controlled by you, like a temperature or something like that. And if, as this variable I goes up and down, if A is, imagine, correlated directly with A, so as I increases, A also increases. They are correlated with this variable, yes? And then you have B that has an opposite correlation. So it means that as I increases, B decreases. Okay? And so what is happening is that you have this uncontrolled variable that can be a temperature, room temperature, but something affects these variables in a way that due to this variable, these are not independent. So one increases, another decreases. So this correlation will make them dependent, not independent. So you cannot use the formula that I will present to you. Okay, things will be an example. So this is an example where xi increases when xa increases, and where and this xi decreases when xb increases. Okay, this is relation between these three variables that justify this situation. Okay, variables are independent when it happens something like that. So the influence quantity will affect A, but you have XB. This is a noisy line, so XB is completely independent both of XI and XA. And when they are independent, you can use the uncertainty propagation law, as I will show to you. Okay, another way of discussing this is that imagine that you have four variables A, B, C, and D, and imagine that these points represent the natural variability of A in the x in this x of A. Okay, imagine. So this is the national variation of the parameter, yes. And if we take the B, that is, as we do replicate measurements, it varies there, okay. And C and so on. If A varies independently of B, this means that they are independent, they are not correlated. But if A increases, if as A increases, B also increases, and C eventually decreases in a synchronized way, when this happens, variables are correlated, and we cannot use the following equation to estimate the combined uncertainty. And that equation is this equation. In many cases, when this equation is presented, people start to run away from the classroom because they find difficult symbols, difficult mathematical notation. But there are no reasons for this situation. Okay. So the uncertainty propagation laws is an equation used to estimate the uncertainty, in this case the combined uncertainty associated with the final result. This is the combined uncertainty associated with the final result. Okay? And this is applicable when you have a function of x variables A, B, C, and D that will affect this y value. And it is stated that the standard uncertainty associated with final result is equal to the square root of the sum of the squares of the partial derivatives of the final results given the value of the variable to the square times the square of the standard uncertainty associated with that variable, and the same for all the other components. Okay. If we decide to, if we delete this square root and put the square there, you can see another thing. The square of the standard uncertainty associated with the final result is equal to the sum of the square of the partial derivatives times the square of the standard uncertainty associated with each input quantity. We can even say this in a different way. The square of the standard uncertainty of the final result is a weighted sum of the square of the standard uncertainties associated with all input variables, where the weighing factor is the square of the partial derivatives. Let me give you an example. When you have a mean value x that is equal of three results, you have x1, yes, plus x2, yes, plus x3, very nice, then, okay, divide by 3, yes, Picasso would do like that. This a mean value can be represented as a weighted sum where a weighing factor is one third. Okay? Yes? This is exactly the same as taking each term and taking one third of each of the replicates value to get to the mean. This is a mean value is a weighted sum of the single values where each one is affected by weighing factor of one third. This is what we have here. So an uncertainty component is more important if this term, this partial derivative, is larger and the standard uncertainty is larger. Okay. And what does this partial derivative represent? It's also called the sensitivity coefficient. What is the meaning of this weighing factor? Okay. To help us, let me tell that, first of all, it is nice to illustrate that the standard uncertainty that is represented here, this standard uncertainty, since results from a combination, is also called the combined standard uncertainty. Annotation, you have lowercase u with dc. It is frequently used to make sure that we are reporting a combined uncertainty. Okay. Now, coming back, what do we mean by this partial derivative? Okay. Well, this partial derivative is can be represented or discussed by taking an example. You know, examples are very good to explain concepts. Okay, if you have a good example, of course. If you have a bad example, examples are bad to explain anything. Okay, I hope that this will be fit for the purpose. So, imagine that we want to measure something where the final result is y. It is 2 times a variable plus 0.5 times another variable, where this 2 and 0.5 have no uncertainty. You only have uncertainty there and there. Okay, you can represent this mathematical function in a 3D graph. In fact, a 3D surface where for each XA, you take XB, and then you have the result here in the surface. Yes, this is done properly if I press the button for the next slide, where in this case, so we have a specific example where, so you have XA equal to 10.1. Typically, you have some units there. XB with the same units because you are adding them. And this Y has the same units because you have a linear combination of these variables, taking a constant factor there. Okay, so here you have 10.1, 32, and if you combine them, we have 36.2. Okay, so our function is represented by the surface. Okay, now what are the partial derivatives? So the partial derivatives are represent in this case the partial derivatives if you remind something about mathematics, you know that taking this function, the partial derivatives taking xA will be 2, will be there. Then you have the standard uncertainty for xA both to the squares, square of both of these terms, and then the partial derivatives taking xB is 0.5. Okay, and then you have, and if you combine everything, you get the combined uncertainty of 0.87. This is very nice. But what does these two represent? It represents a slope between a slope that represents the variation of the result giving a variation of xA. Yes, so if your xA increase 2 times, the y will increase for 2 times more, 4 times. Okay, this the slope that represents the variation of the final results giving a variation, a unitary variation of xA, this factor, the slope of this surface giving xA, represents these partial derivatives. This also, this is also called the sensitivity coefficient. It means how sensible the final result is taking variation of xA. And you can see here that the sensitivity coefficient is larger for xA than for xB, because if xA varies, when it varies, it affects more final result than when xB varies. Okay, and but the component to be important, you must have a large sensitivity coefficient and a large uncertainty. If the sensitivity coefficient is very high but uncertainty is very low, the uncertainty will be negligible. Okay, and these are the purpose and the meaning of these partial derivatives. In most of the cases, labs do not need to deal with the partial derivatives because there are some well-known particular cases of the regression law. If the measurement result is a linear combination of the values of the different variables xA, xB, xC, and xD, where you have constants k, k, a, and so on together in this equation, and where these constants have no uncertainty, by taking the uncertainty propagation laws, you can conclude that the combined standard uncertainty is the square root of the square of the constant times the standard uncertainty of the variable associated with the constant. And you can easily get here from the uncertainty propagation law. In many cases, you have so-called multiplicative expressions where you have multiplication and divisions, and in that case, the particular case of the uncertainty propagation law is this one, where you have the standard, the combined standard uncertainty divided by the value. We have a number for this. This is a relative standard uncertainty, okay? And you can conclude that the relative combined standard uncertainty is equal to the square root of the sum of the squares of the relative standard uncertainties associated with the different input variable. And you can get here easily by taking this expression and the uncertainty propagation law for independent variables, you get there. And this is very nice to see that from here and from the previous one, you can understand several things. First, since you have here linear expression, xA, xB, xC, and xD, they must have all the same units of the final result. And the standard and combined uncertainty from final result will never be smaller than k times the standard uncertainty associated with each variable. Okay, from this equation. Yes, so this the uncertainty here will be not smaller than k times the standard uncertainty associated with the uncertainty with each input quantities. Okay, and when you have equation like that, then you combine things with typically different units. You have a result with a combination of different units. If you have masses and volumes, you have mass per volume units there. And since things have all different units, they are combined as relative components, since each term has no units because we have relative. So it makes this, all this make sense, like usually happens with mathematics. And you can learn from here that the relative standard uncertainty of the final result will never be smaller than the relative standard uncertainty for each one of these components. This is also very important. Okay. And now, the next stage is to expand uncertainty. And why do we need to expand uncertainty? Because the combined uncertainty is associated with only 68% confidence level. And to expand this, typically, in most of the cases, you can be very pragmatic. In most of the cases, the amount of information that is combined in your uncertainty model that you use to estimate the combined uncertainty is enough to say that you have a large number of degrees of freedom associated with this standard uncertainty. And in that case, you can expand the uncertainty, you can use a coverage factor of 2 to expand the standard uncertainty to 95%, so to expand to this 95%, you take the standard uncertainty and multiply by 2, okay? Or if you want to expand to 95%, you do it by multiplying by 3, okay? This is exactly what you can see from this slide, okay? From this slide, you can see that 2 and 3 are used to expand to 95 and 99% confidence level, respectively. Okay? For instance, if the standard uncertainty is 0.87, you multiply by 2, you get 1.74 and then units. And then you report an uncertainty for a confidence level of approximately 95%. The last stage of the evaluation of the measurement uncertainty is typically to assess and to assess how the uncertainty components, the values of the contribution of different uncertainty components, to check all the calculations and to detect any mistake. If you have a major uncertainty component that is surprisingly major, because you start to get some experience about how relevant can be an uncertainty component, perhaps you have to check that the uncertainty estimate more carefully to detect any problem.